had awakened, as it was his custom early, put on his clothes and had taken his best materials that he had saved all of his life to the artist's quarters, for surely he would need those things to be a good apprentice. And he sat with the artist on this Monday as he walked into the artist's quarters. Michelangelo grabbed a chair and set it right next to where he was and instructed the young man to sit next to him. The young man sat next to the artist as he sat and stared at a slab of stone. The young man watched as Michelangelo stared at this stone. 1 hour had passed, and then 2 hours, and 3 hours, and still the young boy was watching as Michelangelo stared at this slab of stone. He hadn't done much in the little time that he had been there. He hadn't put any of his tools that he had prepared to work, and yet he was still determined to be the best apprentice he possibly could. And so he sat there as hours had passed and watched as the artist stood, just stared at this slab of stone. And don't you know, Pastor, that some 5 o'clock had passed and the boy had went home and knew that if he returned the next day would surely be different. And so he arrived the next day, even earlier than the day before, very eager to put his skills to work. And so when he had walked into the artist's quarters, he had learned that the same chair that was there the day before was the same chair that was there on that day. And the artist instructed him to sit there as he sat and stared at the slab of stone. And so hours had passed by, and the young man is confused as to what's going on here. He had applied to be an apprentice, so was his dream. And as opposed to the artist taking good care of his dream and helping him develop and cultivate that dream into greater possibilities, the artist simply invited him and watched him as he stared at that slab of stone. But the boy didn't say anything. Because he wanted to be an apprentice bad. He wanted to be a great artist. And he thought that if he had said the wrong thing at the wrong moment, then perhaps Michelangelo's mood would have switched and his apprenticeship would have been gone. And so the boy sat there for a week and watched as the artist stared at that slab of stone. And that 1 week had turned into a month, and then that 1 month into 3 months, and 3 months into 6 months. That boy would show up early to the artist's quarters for no other purpose than to sit and watch the artist stare at a slab of stone. 5 months and 29 days had passed, and the boy was fed up, and he just could not sit there and watch the artist do this any longer. So he had mustered up enough courage to ask the artist exactly the purpose of him being there. And so the young man showed up on this day earlier than any other day. He had showed up and more eager than any other day. And he sat in that chair. And as he began to watch the artist stare at that slab of stone, the young man interrupted what the artist was doing and said, "Sir Michelangelo, I told you what my dream was. I shared with you my ambition. I told you where I wanted to go, what I wanted to do. I told you that I want to be an artist of international renown, much like you. And as opposed to taking my dream and making something special out of it, you've opted to have me sit and watch you stare for 6 months at a slab of stone." The young artist Michelangelo looked over to him and said, "Please be quiet, I'm working." And did not know that 6 months later, what was that slab of stone had become what is now known as the famous statue of David. I mentioned this story not merely to create some meaningful levity, but rather to have us reflect on our own lives and our own Christian walks. Can it not be said that the moments in our lives where we really thought God was most disengaged, that God was most disassociated, that God was most uninvolved, that God was most quiet, that we didn't even know God was there. Cannot a case be made that in those moments in our lives, God was really working? I don't know who I'm talking to this morning, but surely there are two or three people who can look back over their lives' journey and say that, yes, there were some moments I didn't think God really had my back. There were some moments he was quieter than I had expected or quieter than I had really hoped. There were moments in my life that I just did not think he was there. But now I can look back over the annals of my own history and I can say that God really was working. I know how I know you can have that testimony this morning, because some of us can look back and say that I'm stronger, I'm wiser, I'm better, I'm so much better because of the work God was doing in my life. I wish I had someone here who would help me be a witness. Well, how do you know God was working? Because the things that used to make you cry don't make you cry as easily, because God was working. I wish I had somebody in here who knew what I was talking about. The people that used to make you mad just don't make you mad as often as they used to, because God was working. Aren't you glad that in the moments of life where you think God is most disassociated, most disengaged, most uninvolved, God is most involved, most engaged, most associated, most involved with what's going on in your life. And so, as this young boy had become angry over the silence that had become of his experience with the artist, that the apostles are here in our narrative, and had become upset about the silence that had become of the Savior. And you know, silence is not always an indication of God's absence. Sometimes silence is really an indication of God's presence. And I know that didn't sound right, but I remember driving from Philadelphia to Baltimore, and my GPS system, Miss Alice, I call her, was directing me from 13th and Catherine to Baltimore. And conspicuously so, she'd cry out, ride west on Catherine Street, turn left onto Broad, and keep straight on Broad, merge onto 95. And she talked to me all throughout the city, Pastor, as if she really knew where I was going. That's a woman with some direction, I may add. And do you not know that when I got on 95, when we had taken the long haul, Sister Alice ain't have much to say to me at all. And for a brief moment, I had thought that my GPS system was broken. But soon as I had taken the early exit, Sister Alice jumped back in and shouted, rerouting. And I guess I mentioned that to say that just because on this long road of life you don't hear God's voice, that doesn't always mean you're going in the wrong direction. And if you slip up a little too early, the God that we serve, who was there at the beginning of the journey, will be right there to reroute you back where you're supposed to. And so here it is, the disciples and Jesus are in church, the Bible tells us. They're on the shore and they're having church. Jesus has just preached a mighty sermon. And then immediately after Jesus had preached this sermon, the Bible says that they experienced a storm. Now, this is interesting, my brothers and sisters, on two points, because Jesus takes his disciples from the classroom to the laboratory, because he's trying to get them to see a lesson that they would not have ordinarily seen. And you notice that in the classroom is where you're taught, but in the laboratory, it's where you're tested. And we all know, for those of us who spent any amount of time in school, that the laboratory experience would be much easier if you spend enough time in the classroom. I guess I'll say that again. You know, those of us who missed it, that the laboratory experience would be much easier for those who paid attention in the classroom. Here they are. They're leaving church and they're about to walk into a storm. I'll say it again for those of us who missed that. They're on the shore having church, but right after church, there's a storm waiting for them. I'll say it one more time for those of us who missed that. They are in church, but right after church, the storm is there. I'll say it one more time for those of us who've been living this Christian life a long time. They're in church, but right after church, the storm happened. And I guess the word there is quite simple. It doesn't take long for the storm to reach your shore.
No, it doesn't take long at all.
In fact, some of us can testify that we've been in church and we've listened to the praise and worship, and we've been edified by the testimony of the saints, and we've been strengthened by the word of the preacher. We've danced to the music, but as soon as our foot hit the asphalt,
all right, you've got
the wrong call, the wrong text message, the wrong hater done got in your ear. You know, it does not take long for a storm to come. It can happen suddenly.
Yes,
the brightest of us experience the darkest of days, and it can happen suddenly. It doesn't take much. In fact, you don't have to invite it.
No, it'll invite you.
You don't have to go looking for trouble. Trouble will find you. Trouble will call you
on your phone.
Trouble will text you. Trouble will send you a Facebook friend request. Trouble will tell you if they love you in one ear and then whisper in somebody else's ear that they don't even like what you got on. Trouble will hug you with one arm and then have a dagger in the other one. Trouble will find you. You don't have to go looking for it. It will find you. And the Bible says that Jesus are with the disciples and they're leaving the shore. And right after the shore, they are going right into a world of trouble. The interesting thing about this moment in the story is that the Bible teaches us that there are other little ships that are around them before they take sail. The writer makes it a deliberate point to tell us that there are other ships that are around them before the ships take sail.
Yeah.
And this is an interesting point on so many levels, Pastor, because if you want to understand the real Christian journey, you have to understand that the only ship that was disturbed by the storm was the ship that had Jesus on it.
All right. That's what it says.
The only ship in the story that seemed to have been affected by the storm was the one with Jesus on it. But there are plenty of ships that set sail, but the only ship that had to go through the storm was the ship with Jesus on it. I like to repeat that so that you all can follow what I'm saying. The only storm that was disturbed was the one with Jesus on it. You know, this defies logic, does it not? For most of us would say that the ship that had Jesus on it should have been the ship not affected by the storm.
But I come
to tell you that sometimes having Jesus on your ship makes you a prime target. I don't know who I'm talking to here now, but anybody who knows anything about Jesus knows that this Christian walk ain't perfect and it ain't easy. I wish I had somebody who would walk with me sometimes. It ain't easy serving somebody who tells you to forgive somebody 70 times 70. That's not easy. It's not easy forgiving folk. We may talk about it in the sanctuary, but that's not easy. When Jesus is on your ship, you become a prime target for the storm, believe it or not. Yes, you do. In fact, the moment everybody start liking you, then you know you got a problem. The moment everybody start talking good about you, then you know you got an issue. The fact is, they'll talk about you because my grandmama said they talked about Jesus. The moment everybody high fives you, the moment everybody pats you on the back, you ought to know that you have a problem. The moment everything seems perfect, just mark that as to come before the storm. Know that it's going to happen.
The first thing I noted,
if you want to make it through a storm, you got to let him lead you.
Yes, sir.
Because notice the scripture says, Jesus is the one who says, let us pass over to the other side.
Jesus says, let us pass over to the other side.
And so the first point is simple, but there's much in it. Let him lead you. Now, Pastor, this is a very important point because Jesus is leading them from shore to shore. Now, Jesus knows where they're going, but he makes it a point not to tell them how they're going to get there. Jesus knows their destination, but he does not really tell them their route. He knows the end, but he does not share with them what's in the middle. And that's often how God works. God would reveal to you the promise, but he won't reveal to you the process by which that promise will be made manifest. He'll show you the end, but he won't show you the middle. He'll show you the conclusion, but he won't show you the middle part. He'll show you what he wants for you, but he won't show you how he's going to get you there. He'll promise a sister a husband, but he won't tell her how many broke, busted, disgusted, no good, lying, cheating Negroes she got to go through to get to him. He'll promise you a house, but won't tell you all the years you got to labor in a 2 or 3 bedroom, and you got to take the early bus. Come on, somebody know what I'm saying. This is what God does. This is a part of God's innate character, telling you what he has for you, but not that he will tell you that your family will one day come to you for help, but he won't tell you the years you got to spend in a pit and then in a palace and then in prison and then back to the palace in order to get there. You know, Joseph's story is a good story to preach, but it was a 12-year process. If we cannot become so intoxicated by the promises of God that we have not yet taking a listening to the process of God.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. You cannot want the promise without the process, and so you let him lead you. But preacher, what are you saying here? You let him lead you. You see, the disciples are fishermen by trade. They are modern-day meteorologists, if you will. No one else knew the climate as good as disciples. They were fishermen. They had been out on the sea before. If anyone should have been leading anybody, it should have been the disciples leading Jesus. But no, they relinquished their knowledge of the sea and allowed Jesus to just lead the way. And this is a very interesting point in the text, my brothers and sisters, because they are disciples. They are fishermen. They know climactic patterns. They know what a storm looks like, whether it's looming on the horizon or not, and yet they allow Jesus to lead the way. Yeah. Isn't it interesting that they pull themselves out of the way in order for Jesus to take the lead? Mm-hmm. There's an interesting idea in this particular act on the part of the disciples, in that although that they are fishermen by trade, and they are able to distinguish the weather patterns and to know how bad it's going to get out on the sea, the Bible teaches us that Jesus is the earthly son of a carpenter. And if it took wood to construct the ship that will go out into the sea, is it not right for us to then philosophically conclude that although the apostles were knowledgeable on the changing patterns in the weather, only Jesus, the carpenter, can tell how much the actual ship could take? I don't know who I'm preaching to. Jesus knows how much it could take. I don't know who I'm talking to. That's why the Bible says the ship got full, but it did not sink. Because he knows how much it can take. I don't know who I'm talking to here this morning, but how many of you know that you serve a God who will never put more on you than you can bear? You serve a God who knows how much you can take. That's why under the heaviest pressures of life, you did not give up. You did not throw in the towel, because the God we serve knows how much you can take. You may bend a little bit, but you won't break. Your smile may crack into a frown a little bit, but you won't cry, because the God we serve knows how much you can take. I dare somebody to get happy this morning and high five somebody and tell them, don't even worry about it. The God we serve knows exactly how much of the storm we can bear.
Amen.
It is, the storm happens. The storm happens, and the storm comes, and the Bible says the disciples get afraid. Which is interesting to me, because they've seen Jesus perform miracles before. They've seen him give sight to the blind and open the ears of the deaf. They've seen him in all of his glory in the past, and so it's interesting that they first would be fearful as opposed to being faithful. What's interesting about that moment, my brothers and sisters, is that what makes us the best of Christians is that we know how miraculous God can be, even in moments it doesn't feel like he is so. You know, I dine often at TGI Fridays, and TGI Fridays have a dish there that I fell in love with. It's called the Cajun Chicken and Shrimp Pasta. If you're ever there, you should try and get it to bless you. I remember the first day I had Cajun chicken and shrimp pasta. It was a glorious day. I didn't think it would be that good. And they gave you a very generous portion of it. And, you know, Pastor, that was 5 years ago.
Yeah, I'm listening.
And now every time I go to TGI Fridays, I still order Cajun chicken and shrimp pasta.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And what I've learned, however, is that every time I get it, it's not always as good as it was the first time.
Yeah. Right.
But I keep going back.
Yeah.
Because I know that even though it ain't as good as the first time.
Yes, sir. Uh-huh. It's still good.
There's still a possibility. There's a potential of it being just as good.
Yeah.
If I get the right chef on the right day at the right time. All I'm trying to say is, my brothers and sisters, sometimes that's how the Christian walk is.
Yes.
You know, the good thing about God is I know that no matter where my life is,
all right,
it ain't always going to be joyful. It ain't always going to be happy. It ain't always going to be up. It ain't always going to be smiling. But I know as long as I got him, there's the potential working out for my good. And so they see this. They are fearful, and it's interesting because they have firsthand knowledge of this miracle worker and his work, and yet they are fearful. And how anti-Christian would it be of us to get afraid every time a storm comes in our life? In fact, doesn't that make us Christian? It makes us more Christian. I mean, are we not the people who believe that you can get in a cage with a lion and fight your way out?
Mm-hmm.
Are we not the people who believe that you can spend time in a pit and be lied on and still emerge victorious? Are we not the people who believe that if you stick me into a fiery furnace, you better believe that another person gonna show up and absorb the heat for me? Are we not the people who believe that you can put me in the belly of a whale, and the same God who watched over me before I was in the belly will be the same God who pulled. I wish I had some.
I worship and I pray.